Good morning, Red Oak Church. How are we today? Good, I hope. All right. So, a couple quick announcements just to get us started, if I could have everybody's attention. All right. The shirts that people ordered that said Red Oak Church, Jim Brown has notified me today that they are in. They are here. If you ordered a shirt, there's Jim. Then he come see you. Afterwards, just stand up in case people haven't seen you before. All right, Jim, he's our pastor of men's discipleship, and he has ordered shirts, or you have ordered shirts, and he took the orders. So if you did, please see him after the service. Also, there have been a couple people who have expressed interest in membership here at Red Oak Church. That's going to happen at the annual meeting where we vote the new members in. Annual meeting is coming up on the 22nd, I believe. Yes, the 22nd. It's going to be after the service. Okay, we vote on the budget for the new year, things that members here vote on, and bring in new members. So if you have not seen me about membership, okay, please let me know. If you have, give me a friendly reminder just in case I haven't seen you before, okay, or I forgot to write it down. Also, the monthly men's breakfast is going to be Saturday, January 14th at 8 a.m. You can get there even at 7:30 if you want to have some fellowship before the start of breakfast. The F3 Armor Run for our children is kindergarten through fifth grade. They are going to meet Wednesday, January 11th from 6 to 8, and then it will start on Wednesdays regularly. Okay, so if you have any questions about that, Jessica Sylvester and Brandy Moriale are heading that up, spearheading that up. Please see them or contact the church office. Our leadership team meeting is going to be held on Monday, January 16th at 6:30 p.m. It's just a reminder for all of you, Monday, 6:30 on January 16th. All right. Annual meeting's been told. The theology class, we have, I believe, three classes left in this course that's been going on for like 2 years. So that will happen this Wednesday at 6:30. We will do the very next one. And then finally, our last announcement from Erica. Where's Erica? Come on up, Erica. You get the microphone. By the way, this is an announcement that I'm excited about, so I would love to have Erica share it with you.
Hello. So we are starting up a mother's group for ROC. We're going to be meeting probably monthly. We have our first meeting coming up on the 16th. It's going to be at 10 a.m. here. It's for fellowship and fostering friendships and faith in our children. So children are invited as well. And that's it.
Excellent. Thank you, Erica. 10 o'clock, right? 10 o'clock, Erica? 10 o'clock. All right. With that being said, I want you to come into today believing in your heart that God can meet you in this place, wherever you are. Yes. Whether you feel like you're on the mountaintop or the valley low, wherever you are in this moment, God meets us right here in worship. Amen?
Amen.
All right, Jim, will you lead us in the call to worship?
Today's call to worship is taken from Psalm 119. I will lift up my hands towards your commandments, which I love, and I will meditate on your statutes.
Remember your word to your servant, in which you have made me hope.
This is my comfort in my affliction, that your promise gives me life.
The Lord is my portion. Amen.
Thanks, Jim.
We're going to start this even a little different than we did in practice, so. Stand up and sing. They just band just looked at me like, what? What's he doing?
No, we said of course.
Of course. Nice and loud, all right? To the glory of God. All to Jesus I surrender all. To him I freely give. I will ever love and trust in him in his presence daily live. And I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior.
to Jesus I surrender, Lord. I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power, Lord. Thy blessings fall on me. And I surrender all.
I surrender all.
I surrender all.
I surrender all.
All to thee.
Surrender. The series that we started last week and are going to continue today and continue on for a while about walking in the newness of life has so much to do with the concept of surrender. Sometimes the Lord asks us to lay ourselves down, and it is difficulty and it's challenging. Sometimes it hurts. Whenever God stretches us, and whenever we grow, there's growing pains. But I believe, and we testify together, that where the Lord leads us, he will sustain us. He will grow us, and he will use all things, as it says in Romans 8. All things work for the glory of God to fulfill his purposes in each and every one of us. Amen. Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. And God of wonders beyond our
your majesty. Lord, you are holy.
All right, so last week I talked about a tadpole. You're chuckling. And then a tadpole, when it becomes a frog, not only loses its tail, or as Eric said in discussion after Tuesday, maybe sometimes we can't shake it, it just needs to be chopped right off, right, Eric? Not only do legs grow, but maybe the most spectacular part is that the gills, breathe the water, go away, disappear, and lungs that breathe the air begin to form. You are a new creation in Christ, and your lungs are meant to breathe the Spirit of Almighty God. Amen?
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my and I
ask the band to just keep playing. Once again, not something from practice. Just keep going. Now, I want you to think about what's being sung, because I do believe that there's a prayer in this. What we are saying is, without the Lord, we are lost. Because this world can be hard. Sometimes this world can feel brutal. And in those moments where you want to fight at that, where you're angry at that, there's a voice in your soul and in your spirit that has to look up and say, Almighty God, I am desperate for you. You are the only one that can redeem this. You are the only one that can give hope. You are the only one that can speak to the soul. You are the only one that can give us what we need to sustain. So we are desperate for you. You ever have those moments where you decide you're going to try to do it on your own for a little bit, and you're like, I'm just going to leave the Lord by the wayside for a little bit. And then you turn around and you're like, I don't know what I've done, but I'm lost without you. We're lost. And I'm going to tell you why. You're going to hear more about this today. It has a lot to do with those lungs you've been given to breathe the breath of the Spirit of God. And we can't live and sustain without it. Once the Lord changes you from the inside out, once He touches your life and you are a new creation in Christ, you need the breath of God to feel alive. You need the breath of God, or you feel desperate without Him. Amen? So while we're playing, I want you to, you could just lift up a name if you want. Nothing long, just a name. Take this moment of prayer, and I'm going to start by just saying, Lord, I thank you for this place, because not only am I lost without you, and not only am I desperate for you, but I look around at all the people here, and I'm remembered that I'm not alone, that we are desperate for you. If you have a name you want to lift up, including your own, please do. Ask you keep Shelly Nash and her family in prayer, the passing of her mother. We're going to continue to lift you in prayer. Ask you to keep Ray Rivers. Continue to keep him in prayer as Cheryl passed just after Christmas. Ask you to keep the Schmidt family in your prayers. That God would hold them in the palm of His hand, just as He has their daughter in the palm of His hand now. Eric needs prayer. Eric, we're going to lift you in prayer for your eyes, that your eye disease will find healing, find comfort. Lord God, thank you for the opportunity to worship. Wherever we come from in this moment, be it grief, be it joy, be it triumph, be it tragedy, thank you for the moment to feel the breath of your Spirit lift us today. Thank you, Almighty God, that you love us, sometimes even in spite of us. Thank you that even though we drift away at times, like someone just said, you leave the 99 to find the one and bring us home. Thank you, God, that when we're lost without you, you hunt us down, you cradle us in your arms, you restore us to new life. We are truly desperate for you. Now sing it with me like you mean it from the bottom of your soul. I'm lost without you. Lost without you, Lord. We're desperate. We're desperate for you. Lost without you. Be seated, everyone. Pastor Don, will you share us a word for our offering and then dismiss the kids for junior worship?
It says in Scripture, before we take the offering, in case you missed it, because you've heard me say it before, God loves a cheerful giver. Isn't that right, Tony? Matter of fact, in the Greek it says God loves a hilarious giver. And by hilarious, it means you look at your life and what God has done for you. And I tell you, brothers and sisters, you look and you look deep, because the tomb was empty on Easter, right, Pastor Ryan? And because Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, so will you. Receive Jesus Christ. The greatest gift of all is Him. Amen. And the greatest gift of all is to know Him. And to know Him eternally, even unto eternal life. Please consider what God has done for you. Look deep. Breathe deep. Look deep within your soul. And let this be a time of giving, but let it be a time of thanksgiving in our heart. Because I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, I know this is a fact. You can't outgive the Lord. Amen. Well, the ushers, please come forward now. And everyone, as we sing our doxology together. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I'm thankful today for the things that you did not give us, for the things that you avoided to give us for a reason, so that you might build contentment in our hearts. Oh Lord, we thank you for the greatest gift of all, Jesus Christ, but we also thank you for those things, oh Lord, that you didn't give us, things that weren't good for us. Thank you, oh God, for your providential care. Thank you, O Lord, for your providence. And through Christ our Lord, we pray, and all God's thankful children said, amen. Amen.
It is time for junior worship. Missy, are you ready for this crew? All right. She's ready with a smile even. Which is nice.
Yes. Oh.
So I mentioned to all of you, by the way, before we get into praying for the message today, I just want to remind people, you may have seen signs out front that remind people, now that, you know, this place has been filling up and filling up each week, and what a great blessing to have, that there is overflow parking at the high school. If you are able, if you have spry legs and can make the journey from the high school to here, which is literally right there, okay, we would appreciate that, just to make sure that there's parking for new people that come in. And we will continue, and our leadership team, to talk about more ways to accommodate that. So that's just a reminder. But more importantly for today, you are here. Why did you feel moved in your spirit to come? What drew you to this place? I suspect it's not to be entertained. I suspect that there's something in your new lungs, or in the lungs that God is developing in you, that finds a peace here when the world just can't seem to fill it. Now, we're going to be talking about walking in the newness of life. This is a series that I have no idea how long will go. Because up until Tuesday, I didn't even know it was going to be next week's topic on it. But we talked about that at the end. I said, that's where we're going next week. The newness of life. Every day is new in Jesus Christ. Amen. Right there. I like that. Frank, we got a witness. We got a witness. All right, well, so I'm going to ask Tony, if you would just pray for today's message, that we would take it deep in our heart, because you know as well as I do that everybody here is approaching this topic of newness from a different place. But I believe God has a message for us all in it.
Amen. Good morning, Red Oak. I said, good morning, Red Oak.
Good morning.
I need to know that you are in the house today. Amen. Look at your neighbor on your left and say, neighbor. Look to your left. Say, neighbor. Say, you look real good today. Huh? Now look at the neighbor on your right. Say, neighbor. Say, you look real good. Say, I believe we are all born again. Amen. God has done something in this place. Amen. I see nothing but halos and angels when I look around. Amen. God is so good, isn't he? I believe, Pastor Ryan got some food from heaven for us today. Are you ready to receive what God has for you? Yeah. Amen. It might not be for your neighbor. It might not be for the one on your right or left, but I believe that God wants to speak to you today. And I know that God has anointed this vessel, this priest of this house, this king of this house, to feed us manna from heaven. Are you ready to receive? Amen. Father in heaven, we are so thankful and grateful, Lord God. We come with our hearts bowed down, oh God. We ask it in the mighty name of your son, Jesus Christ. Feed us as only you know how. God, you know what it takes to sustain us. You know what it takes to keep us, oh God, on that path that leads to eternal life. God, as we lay our lives down before you, we ask, Holy Spirit, that you would have your way, not only in this place, but in our hearts. Remove all distractions. Remove everything that will keep us from what heaven has to give us. Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray that every heart, every mind would be regenerated and renewed in the blessed hope of your son, Jesus Christ. Lord God, as we leave this place today, we will never, Lord God, leave in the way we came, because we believe, God, that as this man of God come forth, you have a word for us that will change, that will transform, and that will renew our minds, God. Father, you said that if any man be in Christ, is a new creature, Lord God. And Father God, we embrace the newness of your spirit. We embrace the newness of hope, oh God, that you have for the body of Christ right here at Red Oak at 337 Piper Road. What will you have us to do as your children's God? Father, the church is growing. The church is expanding. And God, I pray that the wisdom and the knowledge of this ministry will expand and grow, that we may know how to feed the people that come in here, oh God. Feed them spiritually. Father, I pray that you would break every barrier that holds back your people today, God. Let their hearts be open to be receptive to the word that is coming forth today. I pray, God, that we would be nourished in our spirit and our spiritual bodies, Lord God. We would be giants in the spirit. I pray for a special anointing. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. I pray for a special anointing upon Pastor Ryan right now in the name of Jesus. God, you said that whatever I ask in the name of your son, Jesus Christ, Lord, you promised that you will do it. And I ask you now that you will use him in a way that you have never used him before. Oh, God, I pray that you will pour out through him miracles, signs, and wonders, Lord God, that when he opened up his mouth, he will speak prophetically. Lord God, when he touched the blind, they will see. When he touched the lame, they will walk and be healed in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord God, let the testimony of this person, Lord God, this vessel, Lord God, this priest, let his testimony be, Lord God, confirmed in heaven. Father, we pray that you would use him in a way, Lord God, that would bless each and every one here today, God. We thank you, Lord God, for in advance for what you're about to do. In the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody say, I receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Pastor. I didn't get up to say all of that. But, you know, God.
It was a fire and brimstone prayer.
God is good, isn't he? Love you, God.
Well, I better be ready now, huh? I like that. Fire and brimstone in the prayer. I got to turn on my other microphone. We're switching mics now. I don't know if that means we've moved up or something. I don't know. Can everybody hear me okay? You got me on the signal, Tiff? We're figuring this out. I got a conversation starter for you today. And I want you just to think about this, okay? You don't have to respond out loud. Matter of fact, I'd prefer if you didn't. I just want you to sit with it in your heart. It comes from an ancient proverb that is not in the Bible. Okay, it's not the text that we'll be preaching from, but it asks a question that I think deserves to be considered. And it says, the frog in the well knows nothing of the sea. The frog in the well knows nothing of the sea. What do you think that means? Just to yourself, think for a minute. A frog in the well knows nothing of the ocean, nothing of the sea. Frog has no idea that what is out there for him is far more plentiful than the small little comfort zone around him. The frog has no idea that what might await him is far more plentiful than the comfort zone that surrounds him. What God has for us, brothers and sisters in Christ, is far more plentiful if we step out in faith and have a vision beyond our comfort zone. I believe that God has far more for each and every one of you, not just for me as a pastor, not just for people that on the worship team or in leadership, that every single one of you. Now, you may be coming to this place right now thinking, I don't know if God has anything for me. Listen, the frog in the well only sees its surroundings until it takes a risk of faith, and sometimes that means stepping out, or in this case, hopping out of your comfort zone, because God has far more for you than you ever dreamed. Now, if you think I mean that means bigger barns or bigger castles or nicer cars, I don't. There is a spiritual sea. And sometimes to get there, God's going to have to part the waters. And sometimes in Scripture, he had to teach people to even walk on water to get there. But God has more for you than what you know right now and what the comforts of the well could ever hint at. He who is faithful with little will be faithful with much. And I believe this is key to this series and key to the vision of this new year, because I believe that God not only has far more for you than what you've had in the past, I believe he has far more for us. So this series is about walking in the newness of life, not because it's a new year. If you remember from last week, it's not because 2022 went to 2023 that we're going to talk about the newness of life. It's because Jesus Christ died and rose again. It's because the resurrection life is something that we can tap into right here and right now, even as paradise awaits us. That there is a newness to life that we can grasp in that has nothing to do with the calendar year or the holiday. And this newness must define our existence. It was built off the metaphor or illustration from last week. The tadpole, once it becomes a frog and has lungs and no longer has gills, it cannot live in the water anymore. If you submerge it in the water long enough, the frog will drown because it needs the air to breathe. And brothers and sisters, I believe we have a whole ocean waiting for us in the breath of God, a whole ocean full of God's Spirit that is going to grow in us this year and next year and every year after. So today we are going to build off last week's illustration and say, okay, leaving the pond, we got to now make our way to bigger waters. It's one thing to have go from gills to lungs and realize we aren't meant for the cesspool that has sometimes precipitated us. But we aren't meant to just sit at the edge of the water or the well either. We're meant to get moving. And so as we unpack this mystery today of walking in the newness of life, we are going to begin with the concept that I think is foundational. And it's about obtaining the mind of Christ. What does it mean? Jared, what does it mean for you? Tom, for you? Christine, for you? What does it mean when Scripture says that you can have the mind of Christ? Because without it, you won't have a vision of the sea and you will know nothing of it and you will stay locked by the well. And never venture out unless God gives you a vision beyond yourself. And every one of you has a destiny in Christ and purposes in Christ that look a lot more like the ocean than the well. Amen? It's central to the understanding of what it means to be the body of Christ. And though it's steeped in mystery, I want to tell you that the mind of Christ is attainable. Not only do I think the mind of Christ is attainable, but according to Scripture, if you've received Jesus Christ, you already have that mind. You may not be in tune with it. Your strings may be out of tune, but you can play. It's there. Look at 1 Corinthians. Let's go to our Scripture lesson for today. 1 Corinthians 2, 12 through 16. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given us by God. I'm going to come back to that later, but I'm going to read it again. We have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given us by God. And we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he's not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. The spiritual person judges all things, but is himself to be judged by no one. For who has understood the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? Now say with me. But we have the mind of Christ. We will have the mind of Christ. We have the mind of Christ. Right now, right here, attainable. What does this even mean? How can it change our perspective? How can it change our vision? How can it call us from the well to the sea and beyond? Well, in the autobiography of Martin Luther King Jr., which was based on Dr. King's speeches and writings, Dr. King wrote about his childhood in Atlanta, Georgia, and I want you to listen to this illustration, and I want it to mean something for us today. He writes, "I remember another experience I used to have in Atlanta. I went to high school on the other side of town to the Booker T. Washington High School. I had to get the bus in what was known as the Fourth Ward and ride over to the West Side. In those days, rigid patterns of segregation existed on the buses so that we had to sit in the back of the buses." A lot of you probably remember this. "Whites were seated in the front, and often if whites didn't get on the buses, those seats were still reserved for whites only. So we had to stand over empty seats. I would end up having to go to the back of that bus with my body." Now listen, listen. "But every time I got on that bus, I left my mind up on the front seat. And I said to myself, one of these days, I'm going to put my body up there where my mind is. It starts in here. What do you believe? What do you believe about God's plans for you? Do you feel like doors have been shut, or have doors been shut but other doors are open, and will you have the courage to journey from the well to the sea? Because unless God puts something in your mind that beckons you to the ocean's edge, you will stay in the comforts of the well and never grow in the mind of Christ. You have the mind of Christ even if you don't know it yet. It's attainable. It's here. Even if you don't find it realized in your life, it seems like it must have something to do with believing and envisioning that we belong up there in the front, if you will. We belong up in the heavenly places. As Martin Luther King Jr. said, the front of the bus. To change our behavior, we first have to see ourselves with changed minds. See ourselves up where we belong with Christ." And as soon as I read this illustration from Martin Luther King, as soon as I read him say, "I left my mind up in the front and knew it was just a matter of time, but one day the body's going to catch up with the mind," I went right to Colossians 3. When I preached this on Tuesday, you started smiling. You went to the same place, didn't you, Pastor Don? Amen. Right? Listen to Colossians 3 because it speaks to this. "If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is. Seek the front of the bus," as Martin Luther King put it. "Seated at the right hand of God, set your mind on things that are above, not on the things that are the earth. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory." See, there's going to come a time when the body's going to catch up with the mind. There's going to come a time when the body's going to catch up with the mind. A vision that sees us at the seashore with the Red Sea parting and all, that sees what we're destined for. Our thoughts, I've used this in the past and I'll keep using it. I think it's very helpful, right? Our thoughts, when they're repeated, become our words. Our words, when they're repeated, become our actions. Our actions, when they're repeated, become our habits. Our habits, repeated, become our character. And your character will ultimately lead you to your destiny. But it starts by saying, "I belong up there with Jesus, and one of these days, the rest of me is going to catch up. One of these days, I'm going to start journeying from the well to the ocean. And you will find that the journey is where you're going to see God work in your life the most." Amen? Amen. Now let's go back, right? Let's go back to the scripture lesson for today. I want to unpack something in this. Notice again what it says in 1 Corinthians 2:12. "Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given us by God." Why do you have the Holy Spirit in your life? So that you can understand that you have been given a gift by God. You have been given the mind of Christ by God. You have been given the ability to understand and see what God is doing. Sometimes that's hard. How many people have been in situations where you're like, "Lord, I don't know what you're doing"? Raise your hand if you've been there more than once. Okay? It's nice to know I'm not the only one. There have been times where I was on my knees saying, "God, I know you're there. You've shown me that you're here, but man, I don't understand what you're doing." But we have to trust that in time God is going to reveal things to us, that His Spirit is going to lead us and guide us, and in spite of what comes our way, God has not stopped working. God still has oceans for us to reach and seashores for us to find. It has to define our perspective. The goal of the mind of Christ is to understand the things that are freely given. And it's not given in gold and riches, but it's a mind to see things differently with spiritual insight. How many of you would like to have more spiritual insight to understand the things that you see in your life? Verse 13, and we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit. Interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. Listen, spiritual truths make no sense to the natural world. The natural mind can't comprehend it. It takes an opening from the Spirit of God, right? Where it says in Romans that all things work for good for those who love the Lord and are called according to His purposes, right? We mentioned that in worship. All things, not some things, somehow in the mystery of God, everything we encounter on the journey from the well to the seashore is going to be used to bring us to our destiny. But it doesn't always make sense. There's been many times in my life that that journey didn't seem to make sense. But that's where faith kicks in. That's where trust kicks in, where we have to be able to say, Lord, I know that You have given me Your Spirit and You will open my eyes to this journey more and more if I just have the courage to step forward, because I don't belong here at the well. I was meant for the ocean. I don't belong here in the back of the bus to West Side. It may take a while for the rest of me to catch up, but by the grace of God, no matter what comes down in my life, I'm going to keep envisioning myself up there with Jesus. And that, brothers and sisters, is the exercise of faith. And the more it doesn't make sense, the more you're told to get to the back, the more the world beats you down, the more you must envision the front. Because He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Amen? Verse 14 says it again. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. They're folly to him. He's not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. You need spiritual eyes. You need the Holy Spirit in your life to understand what God is doing and how He's growing you, because if not, this world has the ability to drown you. More people drown in the well than they do on the way to the ocean, spiritually speaking. The spiritual person judges all things but is himself to be judged by no one. Now, I gotta make a point here, right? I want you to notice something. It does not say that the spiritual person judges everybody. Says judges all things, right? If you think that, oh, I have the mind of Christ, so I get to go around and judge every person, like I'm the judge rather than God, there is no mind of Christ in that. You checked out of the mind of Christ. I don't know what mind you're on, but it ain't His. It says that we can judge all things. We are given discernment. Discernment is a gift from the Spirit of God, is it not? Amen. Do we not see that even in 1 Corinthians 12? Right? He talks about discernment, right? We're given the ability to discern the things that are happening in life. So even when they don't make sense, in faith we step out. And before you know it, as you're hopping along, right? Or walking along, as you're journeying, as you have the air, the breath of life in you, and you don't have the gills for the pond, and you say, I'm destined over here. As you journey, you're going to look back one day and you're going to see that path. How many times I've heard my father say this in his life. I had to look back and say, wow. Wow, look where God has brought me. I didn't understand it at the time, but He's given us His Spirit so that one day, as we take steps of faith, things are going to be open to us and we are going to see the purposes of God. You are not meant to judge people, but you are given the Spirit to discern the things in your life and see how they work to grow you in the newness of life and in the image of Jesus Christ. Amen. And all things will be used for that purpose. mind of Christ. It's the ability to judge what things are from God and what things aren't. Again, I am not saying you're going to understand it all the time. If I say that to you, I would be a wild hypocrite, because there are things in my life I still don't understand. But what he will give you as you journey is this spiritual intuition to learn what things are from God and what things are trying to drag you back to the pond. And if you don't think the enemy is going to put things in your life to drag you back to the pond, you are setting yourself up to drown. If you don't think the enemy is going to try to drag you back to the pond, you are setting yourself up to drown, right? You're going to learn what things are from God and what not. Selfishness, greed, laziness, jealousy. We know these are the things that are not of the Spirit, not born of the Spirit. And we have to learn, as the Bible says, to crucify that nature so that we can see with clear eyes, unveiled eyes, the things that we were meant for. God has plans and purposes in your life, and nobody and no thing can take that from you. No loss can take that away from you. God has plans for your life, and he's going to give you the Holy Spirit to uncover it. You just have the, this is going to be a little weird, but you got to have the journey as a new frog, right, to take a bit of a jump once in a while. Because it's in that process of jumping that your eyes will begin to see more clear, that your lungs will begin to fill with the breath of God. Yes, we have new lungs. We might not live, and I got to say this, because let me just take this rabbit trail. We laughed about this on Tuesday, didn't we, Lou? Okay, you probably know where we're going. Listen, having the mind of Christ, to me, is synonymous with a quest for meaning and purpose in this world. Where is the Lord leading me? How is he helping me find the way, find the purpose in all things, and learning to discern what is from God in the sea versus what is from the world and the well is a process, right? Because too often, and I want you to listen to me here, too often when we know that something's not of God, we run back to it anyways because it's a lot more comfortable at the well we've always known than the sea that we don't. Listen, sometimes you realize, ooh, I've been made new in Christ. Something's different about me, but I can't leave the comforts of the old. They're too comfortable. Now, if I sit in the old for too long, I'm going to drown. So we find a nice lily pad to sit on. And we think that we're a new, look, I'm a new creature, new creation in Christ. I'm sitting on a lily pad now. Tadpoles can't sit on a lily pad. Ribbit, yeah. Ribbit, things are all different for me now. You still don't know the sea when you're sitting on the lily pad of the pond. You still don't know what the Lord has for you. And sometimes, brothers and sisters, please hear me on this. Sometimes the comforts of the pond, the comforts of the well, will keep you stuck in life, and you will not grow until faith calls you to head for the water seashore. You aren't meant, if you think, and listen, churches got to come alive in this. Christianity has to come alive in this. If you think that your job as a new creation in Christ is to sit in the lily pad of the old pond and wait for Jesus to come, you will end up drowning. Let me say it again if you didn't hear me. If you think your job in Christ as a new creation in Christ is to sit in the lily pad of the old pond and wait for Jesus to take you to the ocean, you will feel like you're drowning. Because you weren't meant for that pond. Not its lily pads, not its little sandy beach, none of it. You were meant to head to the ocean, for the sea. You're gonna feel stuck, right? You're gonna feel stuck. But for us, Christ represents, as Dr. King said, the front of the bus that we must envision.
I'm going to go through a whole practical section on this next week. I decided to split this sermon in two, and we're going to go into Philippians, and we're going to go into places in Colossians, and we're going to talk practically what it means in moments, in real life moments. I'm excited to preach it next week, okay? About real life moments. What does it mean to take the mind of Christ that's already there? But before we even get there next week, you need to be willing to step out of your comfort zone. The practical application of this week is beware that the enemy doesn't put the comforts of the pond back in your life just to get you to sit complacently on a lily pad, because you aren't meant for it. Today is about getting a vision of the front of the bus, of the heavenly places, and it may take a while for the rest of us to catch up, but that is where your destiny lies. That is what God has for you. And again, I'm going to say it, everything in your life is going to be used by God. All things will work for those who love the Lord, called according to his purposes. They're all going to work for good. Even the most heart-wrenching of things is meant to get you to hop to the ocean. And the tragedy is rejection, pain, loss are the things that too often keep us stuck on the lily pads of life, afraid to step out. Today's message: there are fears in life, and you have to jump anyway, because you weren't meant for fear. You have not been given the spirit of fear, but the spirit of sonship, to see where God is growing you. The frog in the well knows nothing of the sea. It will never venture far beyond the limitations it knew as a tadpole unless it believes it belongs somewhere else. Now, as I close, I want you to know something. A storybook was developed off that ancient saying about the frog. And in the story, do you know when the frog finally started journeying out? When the well dried up. When the words, "I'm desperate for you and lost without you." And in that story, the water dries up and the frog's food supply dries up. So think of today as a warning to us. If you stay only in the worldly things, eventually it's going to dry up. And you will have to decide, is it time now for me to hop out of the comforts of old that were there for me at a time but aren't sustaining me any longer? Maybe it's time I head to the ocean. Eventually, the wells of this world will dry up, brothers and sisters, and you have to have a vision beyond your mortal mind, one that knows you're destined for greater things, even if they come in humble packages. Like Martin Luther King, you have to have a vision that one day your body is going to catch up to where your mind is. Let's pray. Almighty God, I know in this room right now that all of us in some way are familiar with the comforts of the well. And I know at times it's going to make us feel like we're drowning and stuck. And I know faith has to give us the courage to step out, even if we're afraid. We have to believe that we belong up there in the heavenly places with you. And I know it goes on in this room right now because I know that I wrestle with it too. And so, Father, as your word says, it's your spirit that will help us to understand and give us the courage to step out in confidence. So may your spirit ignite courage in us today. May your spirit remind us that our lungs were meant to breathe the air and not drown in the water. May your spirit remind us that in your time, our bodies will catch up to where our mind is. And all God's people say, amen.
Stand up, everybody. Are we ready to praise and worship God?
Come and breathe on the coals of my heart. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, till it's all that I know. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, so I never grow cold. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, with a single obsession. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, with an endless passion. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, with a single obsession. Set me ablaze, set me ablaze, with an endless passion.
Our benediction. You know, a lot of times we'll say a benediction and we'll play another round of the song we just ended. And I think what I'd like to do, and I know everybody wants to probably gather and there's excitement and all that, but what I'd like to do is for people that need prayer, who feel stuck, who are beginning to grab a vision for the front, but are having a hard time getting their body to catch up with where their mind is. Or feel like they've been sitting on the lily pad too long looking at the same pond. I just want people to be able to come forward, and I'd love to pray with you. I know others would love to pray with you as well. Pastor Don, Tony, and Jim, and Irene, Lynn. So I'm going to ask for us to, as upbeat as that was, I'm going to ask for us to just leave quietly. And leave a space in this moment. Once you get downstairs, you can hoot and holler and eat cake. Just don't throw it at each other. But I'm going to ask you to leave in peace. And for people that need to remain for prayer, whether they stay in their seat and just pray quietly, I believe that in the soil of renewal, there has to be a whole lot of prayer. And so we're going to end with prayer time. I invite you to stay and pray. I invite you to come forward and have us pray with you. And if you head downstairs, make sure you look at each other. And as you said before, see the beauty of what God is doing right here, right now, on our way to the ocean.